Good afternoon, and I would like to welcome everyone to Conversations with the Superintendent. I would like to thank WCTV for the use of their studio and hosting and allowing me to host this show. I think it's been a great way for us to introduce various people in the school system to the members of our community. Today's guest is Mrs. Joan Seamans, the principal of the Minot Forest Elementary School, the East Elementary School, and the Ethel E. Hammond Elementary School. You may be shaking your head, wondering, how can one person be the principal of three buildings? Joan does an excellent job. She has students in pre-K through grade five split in three buildings. And today you'll find out a little bit about why we have three buildings and why these grades are split into these three schools. So at this time, we'd like to take a break and we'd like to take a tour of the buildings so that you can see what we're going to be talking about today from Minot Forest, the Ethel Hammond School, and East Elementary. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Joan Seamans in my office here at the Minot Forest School. One of the items on the renovation and expansion project for the Mass School Building Authority is replacing the windows at Minot Forest. And my office is a perfect example of why. As you can see, we have plastic on the windows. It's to try to keep the draft from coming through. It gets very cold in here in the winter time. So the plastic helps a little bit, but if we can renovate the windows and have new windows installed, it'll be a lot more energy efficient. This is the work area for the teachers. You can see it's right here in the office area, and it's very noisy. They don't have a separate spot to do their work, to running off all their papers. And sometimes when the secretaries are on the phone, it's hard to hear on the phone because of all the machines that are running. We also have in the office area a master clock that no longer works in our intercom system. Sometimes it's quite difficult for the classrooms to hear. It's old. It needs to be replaced.
Yeah. This is our chairlift. So if we need to get from the lower part of the building up to the cafeteria or the second floor, we use this. It's also old and breaks down quite a bit, so we have to have it repaired a lot. So with a renovation and expansion project, we'd like to have that replaced. We have an elevator on the other side of the building that can get up to the second floor, but the elevator doesn't encompass this part of the building, so we have to have the chairlift for this side of the building. And here we have our shower room. Used to be used for phys ed, but because of space, we now use it for two special education teachers, so they share this space. They've done a great job trying to make it look lively and colorful for the children, but it still is a shower room.
Still has the original tile, right?
Original tile, and the shower stalls are in the back. They don't let the children in the back there, but they have their workspace here that they use. This is the study skills office. The study skills teacher does not have a classroom. She's on a cart. So we've taken over the physical education office in order for her to have a space to have her things, and she can work with children if she needs to at times, but it's a place for her to store her things. Yeah, that's one of the clocks. It no longer connects to the main clock. So we have to have these manual ones. With the master clock also and the electrical system, we don't have any bells that ring at Minot Forest. So updating the electrical is another part of the renovation expansion project. This is Mrs. Quimby's cart for study skills. So every day she has to push this through the hallway to get to the classes so she can do her lessons. This is our library. Unfortunately, it's not used as a library at this time because it needs to house the Title I program. So we have several adults in here, three or four at a time, working with small groups of children. Because we don't have any empty classroom space where they could use that instead, they're here in the library working with children. We don't have children taking out books because the librarian no longer works for Wareham. Due to budget cuts several years ago, it was a position we cut,
knowing that we had a space issue and we had to house the Title I program here. So there's no librarian anymore. This is an example of an electrical outlet that we had to cap over because it's too close to the sink and it's not connected to the ground fault plugs. So for safety reasons, we've had to cover that over. Unfortunately, it eliminates two outlets that the teachers can use in the classroom. And with existing technology and increasing technology, we're finding we don't have enough outlets in the classrooms. So again, with the renovation expansion project, we're hoping to add a few more for the teachers to use. These are the portable classrooms. There are four. They were added onto Minot Forest in 1994, but they came to us being 10 years old. So they've been here quite a while. There's only one heater in the hallway, and it's electrical heat, so it's not energy efficient. And in the cold winter months, and you can kind of feel it now, it gets very cold in the hallway. We've had to replace the tile on the floor about a year ago, just because we had some soft spots in the floor, so we had to reinforce it with plywood and remove the carpeting that was here because that was getting very thin, and replace part of the tiling in the hallway in the classrooms. The portable classrooms, they're a bit smaller in size. They also were pretty chilly in the winter time because the heating units on the roof weren't energy efficient, so we did install small heaters on the ceiling. It does help with the heat, but it's still a little chilly in the winter time. This is one area. We use as much space as we can here at Minot Forest, but our foster grandparent works here, Grandma Enos, and she's part of the Coastline Elderly Services Program, and we love having her. She comes in, she reads with children, and this is her little space, so we enjoy having her. This is a classroom that is used by three teachers. Again, because of lack of extra classrooms, we have three special ed teachers that are sharing one space. So as you can look in the room, you can see they try to separate their area using bookcases, charts, desks. But in this one room, you can have three groups of students going at one time. This is an example of our open circle program, and at the beginning of the year, all the students in every classroom trace their hand with their name by saying they would agree to follow the open circle contract by acting with respect, responsibility, and kindness in school. And those three words are the theme for Minot Forest: respect, responsibility, and kindness. Life Touch Photographers was kind enough to donate this poster for our school that shows our theme of respect, responsibility, and kindness. In addition, we have the art teacher, Mrs. Lennon, who's working with the Open Circle Sustainability Team. And we're going to be painting not only these three words throughout the building, but also the phrases, this is important, you can do it, and we won't give up on you. We're trying to instill a positive message to our students that we're very proud of. And by working on this project, the students will be able to see these words throughout the walls, and they'll come to feel good about themselves and their school. This is an example. Every month we do a word of the month for our social competency program. This month we're focusing on effort. We've done respect, responsibility, kindness, consideration, and right now we're doing effort. So the students get a star every time they show effort to their teachers. So we're off to a great start this month. This is an example of our PTA board, and we have two programs. One is called Blast Into Books, where students are asked to read every night, keep a tally of the amount of minutes that they read, and once they read 240 minutes, they bring in their reading log, and they receive prizes, and they get to go around the world. We also have our Math Wonders program, which is the same theme. Once students practice math activities, totaling up to 240 minutes, they bring in their math contract, and then they get prizes as well. So different grade levels have different items. You'll see down in the hallway that students can travel around the world and go to different planets. And every time they get to a new planet, they get a new prize. So we're very proud of this.
Hi, my name is Nancy Ames, and I'm the assistant principal here at the Ethel E. Hammond School, as well as the East Wareham School, which we'll be visiting in a little while. I'd like to take you on a tour of the building and give you some highlights of our school. One of the strengths of the Ethel E. Hammond School is the staff. It's an incredibly hardworking staff that currently work with kindergarten students, transitional one students, and first grade students. Our transitional one class is a district-wide program that houses students from both sides of the town. So let's walk upstairs and we'll look at some of the classrooms. Hi, this is Cindy Travis's classroom. It's a typical kindergarten classroom filled with bright colors and lots of decorations on the wall to assist the children in calendar skills and counting skills. They're allowed to use the computer. They work in small group settings as well as individually and whole group settings. Hi, this is one of our hallways. You'll be able to see a lot of the drawings and good work that our teachers have done with our students. You'll notice that they are adding shapes and colors as well as some English language art skills. We love to display the work of our students. They take pride in their work. This is one of our resource rooms for students that require extra remedial help with Mrs. McLaughlin, our special ed teacher, and Mrs. Mann, one of our permanent intermittent subs. They work in here with small group setting to mirror the academics that are offered in the classroom with extra accommodations and modifications to assist the children. Hi, this is Mrs. Denise Yop's classroom. She is our transitional first grade classroom teacher. She currently has 9 students that are from both sides of town. It is a district program. It is for students that were not quite ready for first grade, however, had mastered most of enough of kindergarten to move on. We are fortunate to have this program. It's helped many students over the years. Hi, this is Mrs. Denise Yop's classroom. She is our transitional first grade classroom teacher. She currently has 9 students that are from both sides of town. It is a district program. It is for students that were not quite ready for first grade, however, had mastered most of enough of kindergarten to move on. We are fortunate to have this program. It's helped many students over the years. Hi, this is Gina Femino's classroom. She is a full-time kindergarten teacher who teaches 2 half-time classrooms, one in the morning, one in the afternoon. We're very fortunate to have that program. As you see right now, she's getting ready for school tomorrow and setting up her classroom. So when the kids come in, they'll find a fun activity around St. Patrick's Day. Hi, this is Mrs. Vermilier's classroom. She is our half-time math reading interventionist for our first graders and our transitional one students here at Hammond School. We were really lucky to be able to get that position this year. It is just less than one half, 2.5 hours a day. It's an incredible advantage to our children. The disadvantage is that she's not here all day to service more children and for longer times. But we are lucky to have it at this time. And if you look around the classroom, you're going to see how she's taken the work from the classroom and brought it into here to make the accommodations and enrichment activities that go along with classroom activities so that the children can transition easily back into class. If you can hear the children's voices in the background, out in the auditorium of our school, Wareham Child Care contracts with the school system to be able to use our building for before school and after school child care. This is a great advantage to our parents and our community to ensure the safety of our students. Ethel E. Hammond School has the advantage of being able to use a room for our sensory room for our occupational therapist and physical therapist to meet with our students. This is a great advantage for our students who require those services. This is our physical education classroom. It's housed in the basement of the Hammond School. The downfall of Hammond School at this time is that we are not physically handicapped accessible. So students who require the use of a wheelchair or cannot do stairs cannot access this floor. This is our art room at the Ethel E. Hammond School. Again, like the gym class, it is housed in the basement, so it is not accessible to handicapped students. However, we are fortunate to be able to offer the different programs for our students that do attend here. The art room abuts the boiler room, so the children cannot enter or exit through this door. They must go out the other door. That is one of our disadvantages here at Hammond School, is that two parts of the building do not connect for children to be able to access. And that does cause a problem, again, especially with students who cannot use stairs. As you can see, our equipment is a bit old, but we have wonderful cafeteria staff that do the best they can and always provide our students with a healthy breakfast and lunch. We're currently standing in the room that used to be the library. Unfortunately, librarian positions have not been filled for a few years, and we use this room now for two reasons. Mr. DeVoe is our music teacher who provides the students with a great music enrichment program, and as well, you can see, we still house a lot of the books and we have all of our theme packages over here so that the teachers can come down and access different themes for the programs that they're doing in their classrooms. Under the direction of our first grade teachers, our students made the constitution for the Hammond School, and they came up with these rules themselves, which include treat other people the way you want to be treated, not bully anyone in school, always talk quietly in school, keep our hands and feet to ourselves, always speak respectfully to one another, we will try our best, and we will keep our school clean, and all of the students sign the Constitution. One of our initiatives at the Hammond School this year is the Toucan program, and Toucan has taught us that you too can have a great school year. Once a month, I meet with all of the students in their classroom, and we learn a new word each month regarding character education. The students are given activities to bring home to complete with their families, and the children seem to really be enjoying this and learning educational skills. Hello, we're now at the East Wareham School, which houses our preschool students. As you see, we have a somewhat sparse playground that our children use. We are in the process of working with the playground committee in hopes to develop it into a more age-appropriate and educational type setting. As well, one of the problems and disadvantages at East Wareham School is our parking. It's very limited, and our neighbors have been very cooperative and nice, as our parents who pick up students have to park along the street because this parking lot fills up so easily. Sorry, East Wareham School has three floors, and we access all three floors with the use of stairs and an elevator that was added on several years ago. Like the Hammond School, we do have a sensory room here for our students that require fine motor and physical motor activities. This is a classroom that is multi-purpose at this point. In the afternoon, it houses one of our new preschool programs for extended day students that spend their afternoon in this classroom. In the morning, it still continues to be used for both music lessons and art classes. Unfortunately, we are completely full at the East Wareham School and have no extra space at all for our specialists. So in the afternoon when our students have specials, the specialists have to actually go into the classrooms. The music teacher, we've worked out the schedule so that the art teacher is not here in the afternoon because it's pretty hard to get cart around this building. But our music teacher is able to carry his instrument and his books with him. So it was a lot of scheduling that we had to do. But our specialists go between Hammond School, East Wareham School, and Minot School. So they're quite busy. This is Ms. Kirsted's integrated preschool classroom. We have three classrooms that offer afternoon and morning programs. The students attend anywhere from 2 to 4 days a week, depending on need and age. As well, we have two other classrooms that are full day classrooms, depending on the disability of the child. We have students that range in disability and ability in this school. This is Ms. Scott's classroom, who's sitting at her desk right now. We're very fortunate to have her. This is one of our full-day, substantially separate classrooms, where she currently has 8 children and 2 assistants who work very collaboratively and closely with her to ensure a very enriched preschool program for these students. Hi, we're in the basement floor of the East Wareham School, and this is a multi-purpose room. It is used every day as a teacher's room for their lunch and for conference meetings. In addition, for inclement weather, physical education classrooms are held in this room. So as you see, it's sort of limiting for the amount of kids that we can have in here for any type of gross motor activity. But we are fortunate enough to have staff that are able to utilize the space appropriately. They usually are able to work around this area without moving the tables. However, we've had to have assemblies down here when we have outside enrichment programs come in, where we have all the kids down here and we've had to move the tables. This is Mrs. Tobin's classroom, one of our other full-day, substantially separate classrooms. It's housed in the basement floor of the East Wareham School. However, you can see how bright and cheery it is. She's made it quite colorful with lots of graphic visuals all over the classroom for the children. She provides a lot of hands-on activities as well as activities that entail text, books, reading, math manipulatives.
Well, welcome back. It's exhausting. We've been to 3 separate buildings.
I know.
And because of some time constraints, your assistant principal, Nancy Ames, was good enough to do the tours
yes.
at East and at the Hammond schools. Why don't we start talking, first of all, about Minot Forest. This last year and really the year before, you submitted a SOI, a statement of interest to the Massachusetts School Building Authority to renovate and to expand the Minot Forest School.
Correct.
Can you tell us why you think the Minot Forest School needs to be renovated?
Absolutely. There's a couple of reasons that we're looking for as far as renovation is concerned. The windows in the building are original. So they're very thin paned. If you come by my office now, anytime in the winter, you're going to see plastic over the windows. And it's not because I don't enjoy the beautiful view out there, but the draft that comes in through the windows is quite chilly. In fact, one year I had a computer that kind of froze and we couldn't get it to operate anymore because it got to be so cold. So replacing the windows in the building is one area that we need to fix. We need to upgrade the electrical in the building. We have a lot of new technology with the 21st century. However, we still only have 2 outlets in the classroom for the teachers to use. So we don't have enough to support what we would like to bring into the school system. One of those outlets that the teachers had can no longer be used because it was over the classroom sinks. It's a safety issue right now, so we had to cap those off. I don't have a master clock that works at Minot, so we can't have any bells to ring. So when the children are outside for recess, we have to rely on the teacher watchers in order for them to come in and be there on time. We have used absolutely every space available at Minot Forest. We've taken over the former shower room for the gymnasium. We have three special education teachers sharing one classroom space. They're trying to separate their little areas by bookshelves and chart stands. We have art on a cart because we don't have a classroom for the art teacher anymore, which makes it difficult because she's doing art projects and not all the classrooms have sinks. Study skills is on a cart as well, so both of these teachers are pushing their carts through the hallway and using the elevator to get to the different levels. Parking is an issue at Minot Forest. We don't have adequate parking as it is, and in the morning we have so many parents dropping children off. One day we counted 108 in a 10-minute span. So we have cars parking, they're on the street at Minot Forest trying to get into the small lot that we have. And at the end of the day, again, parents are just trying to find a place to park. The grass, the edges of the driveway. We have parents leaving, we have buses coming in. There's only one access to Minot Forest, and it causes quite a traffic jam. So I'd like to have that redesigned. In addition to the renovation, I'd like to expand Minot Forest, again, because we don't have a lot of classroom space. We had to put several classes over at the Hammond School. We had to relocate the local daycare because we ran out of space in the cafeteria for after-school programs. Wareham Child Care is now renting space from Hammond. So if we can renovate and expand, we can add another wing onto Minot Forest to give us additional classroom space. And my goal would be to house everybody at least K to 5 under one roof. That would make it more efficient of our time as administrators, and grade levels won't be split. The children can be with their peers, and I'd love to see that happen as well. I could go on and on, but those are the basics.
Thank you. Let's look at Hammond. What year was Hammond built?
I believe it was 1966. May even be before that.
No, that was Minot.
That was Minot Forest, that is correct.
Hammond is over 100 years
old.
Yes,
it is quite old.
And it's a wooden structure.
Mm-hmm.
Is it handicapped accessible?
Not fully. We have a ramp on Highland Ave, so you can access the main floor, the auditorium and the top classrooms. But other than that, you cannot get to the lower floor because we do not have an elevator in that building.
And if you determined that you wanted to hold some function in your auditorium during the day, what would be the downside of that?
Well, we have buses that are coming in and out during the day. So we have our half-day kindergarten children leaving in the morning. Then we have the afternoon session coming in. So we have buses trying to park. We have parents that are pulling up to pick up children, drop children off. We have four classrooms right off the auditorium. So if there's anything happening in the auditorium, it would be noisy. And then depending on what the function is, you know, if it's visitors coming into the building, now we have a safety issue of having outsiders in the school amongst our children. Volunteers always have to be queried, so we're always thinking about safety measures. And then making sure people don't leave the auditorium to walk down the hallway.
In the auditorium, if I recall, there are two front entrances to the auditorium, and there's there two back entrances as well?
There's one main entrance, which is on Highland Ave with the ramp, and there's two side doors, but they're locked, and we don't typically use those.
But into the school, if I walked up the flight of stairs from the office, and
yes,
I was going up, I could go in two different ways if I'm...
Oh, you're correct. At the end of the hallway, you have to take either a right or a left, and a brings you back to the auditorium.
So when you're trying to lock down an area to, let's say, be used by the community, the difficulty is that there are six or seven different ways in and out of that space.
Right, and there's no door to lock to block off the auditorium from the rest of the school.
I know one of the other issues with Hammond and using it for community activities is that with our kindergarten children. As you say, we had some half days, we have some full days, And we have a number of children who have special needs mm-hmm. and are not yet, they're not comfortable with a full day of school yet. And therefore, there may be some acting out behaviors and such that somebody coming in from the public might not understand.
Correct.
Or may make judgments about a child that really aren't fair, because the teachers and the professionals in that building understand how to respond to those behaviors. And sometimes it's not responding is the right way of responding, and somebody else has a hard time understanding that.
And sometimes it's the nature of the disability for children. If they're a nonverbal child, they can't speak, so the only way they can communicate is to act out or, you know, yell out. And to an untrained person, they may not understand that behavior, as you said, but the teachers come to know the children and understand what it means, and they know how to intervene and give the child strategies that an outsider would not know.
Let's look at the East Wareham School. The East Wareham School, I believe that's Depot Street.
Yes.
That it's located on. That's where we have pre-K. And are there some things that you'd like to see that are would make that a better location? Or
the parking, again, is very difficult. We only have parking on Knowles Avenue. I have to say the neighbors have been great, trying to be good neighbors to us. When we have functions at East Wareham School, it's difficult because the families are parking everywhere. When they're picking up their children from school mid-morning or afternoon, I know the cars are parked, you know, all down the street. And we try to ask parents not to park in front of their driveways or block their mailboxes. We do as many reminders as we can about that. But there's just not enough parking. It's such a small area. We are trying to work on a playground right now for East Wareham School and Hammond as well. The PTA is trying to help us with that. So we would like to see that improve. And we're using, again, just every space we can in that building right now with all of our preschool classrooms.
Great. Tell me a little bit more. At East Wareham, we have that fenced off area where the playground is, and it's a community playground as well as the school uses it. So where are we in the planning stage for upgrades to that?
We have been working with one particular company right now. We have a playground committee, which is teachers and PTA parents. And the representative, Mr. Knotts, has come out to look at the area, and he's in the process of designing some phases for us that we can work with. We're very fortunate to have a private donation from a community member that has allowed us to have some startup money to look at beginning the playground. Where would we put the structures? Where can we still have an area for gym, for free play, things like of that nature? So. We'll be moving forth with that. And then I know in the future the PTA will try to do some fundraising for the playgrounds.
And I know at the same time, is the same committee also looking at the Hammond School?
Yes, they are. And again, we were very fortunate that the same donor had given us some money for the playgrounds for the Hammond School. And Hammond's very fortunate because we just got accredited from this organization called NIAC, the National Association for the Education of Young Children. We have to fulfill several criteria and standards. The teachers worked so hard on completing this, and we received accreditation for Hammond. And playgrounds is always an issue that we fall short on because we don't have adequate equipment or spacing. So it is something that we know we have to fulfill. We're in the process of going through the accreditation from NIAC for East Wareham School. We had it before, but when we closed the East Wareham School, we lost it. So again, those teachers are now in the process of completing that requirement, and playgrounds will have to be an area that we address.
Do you have an idea of the total cost per project?
Again, you have to do this in phases. You could take $20,000 and not have a complete playground.
But I guess that's what I'm asking. So if you had all the money necessary to do one of these, and no, I don't have a wallet that has all of that money in it. But if you had that, how much were we talking about?
The designer hasn't given us a full estimate yet. But, I mean, playgrounds could go anywhere from $80,000. I mean, depending on what you have for money, you build what your needs are.
What you can afford.
Exactly. We would love to get more donations if we could, because then we could get a playground up and running faster for the children.
What I'd ask, once you on your committee agrees on a set of
plans
and the phases, perhaps that document could be posted onto the webpage.
Sure.
At Minot Forest or under East. Is it one from? Is it the East side of town website?
Each of my schools has their own website.
They do. All right.
So once we get permission from the designer or the playground company to make sure we can post that, then by all means we can.
Yeah, even if it's just not exactly the plans, but some generalizations about what phases.
Sure.
And so that if somebody in the community was looking and wanted to know, okay, you know, you have $20,000, let's say, between the two playgrounds, what do you really need to do it? I mean, I have no idea. So it would be interesting to see that.
Right. Not just the equipment. You have to have ground cover. You have to have walkways. Everything has to be handicap accessible. So there's a lot of things that go into planning and designing a playground.
So we've talked about the facilities. We've talked about, you know, at Minot Forest, as you say, 1966, and is now in 2006, would have been 40 years, and we're 6 years after that, so it's 46 years old. So all of the basic functions or systems, whether it's the heating system, the windows, the energy with electricity, plumbing, virtually everything has to be redone. And
yes,
that's about the time, somewhere between 40 and 50 years, that a building needs to be done. And of course, the benefit is that once we do that, we save some money on fixing things. So right now, instead of having funds to buy new things, some of our money needs to go into the maintenance.
Correct.
Of the facility and fixing things when they break versus buying new things.
And the portable classrooms are a prime example of that, where we had to replace the carpeting in the hallway in two classrooms with tile. We had some soft spots in the floors. One of the roof units isn't working right now, so in the summertime, one of the classrooms doesn't have air conditioning. It happens to be an OT sensory room right now. It's not a classroom. It's electric heat in the classroom, so it's not energy efficient. There's only one teeny heater in the hallway, so it's freezing in the winter. So that's an example of putting a lot of money into things that if we could expand, we could get rid of the portables, because again, those are very old.
Now, my belief is those have been attached to Minot Forest
since 94, I believe.
Since 94.
And they came to us already 10 years old.
So, 94 to 2004, was 10 years. And then to 2014 would be another 10 is 20. And they are 10 years old. So they're, in another year, they're going on 30 years old.
Right.
And the life expectancy of these are 10 years.
Mm-hmm.
And then you have to do a complete refurbish. And it seems like wasting good money after bad to spend up to $200,000 to completely redo the portables when you really need the space.
Right.
And we need a new, an enlargement of Minot Forest as well as a redo.
Mm-hmm.
And that can be done while the school is operating.
Yes.
It has to be planned out, but there are ways of doing that. And in the long run, it will save us a lot of maintenance money. New systems are more efficient should save us some money from operations and supplies. Plus, it allows you an opportunity to get all new technology, which we don't have the money to do. So it really takes care of a lot of things at once. And I hope we can get that project underway.
I hope so. We're still waiting to hear on if our application has been accepted.
Yeah, perhaps next week we can collaborate on writing a letter that we can send to the Mass Building Authority, to the woman who's in charge of that unit. And we have some people in town that seem to know that person. So if we CC the town person, maybe they can also bring it to the person to get a little higher probability that they'll actually look at it, rather than just being one of 100 projects to look at. So we've talked about now all of the physical structures and the needs and so forth. Let's talk a little bit about some of the good things that are happening at the schools at Minot Forest and at Hammond and at East.
Well, this week we're going through MCAS, and the parents have been great as far as calling us if the children are sick, and we absolutely understand that, so we appreciate the parents' support with MCAS, making sure the children are getting there on time. We had an MCAS rally last week, and the children loved it. So we pepped them up, and Mrs. Weatherspoon, one of my paraprofessionals, does a Step It Up program with some students. So they created their own little song, kind of copied one, and put their own words into it, and performed a dance for them. And then we had a parade through the school, so the first and second graders held their signs and cheered them on. So it was great. And the students were ready. So MCAS is always one area that we strive to, you know, make our adequate yearly progress. We have a brand new math series this year called Everyday Math, and the teachers are enjoying it. We're seeing a lot of great results from math with the children. It's an online program as well, so now the children can go home and access math online if families have a computer. So they've all been given their passwords, so the parents can supervise that. We have a new writing program, 6+1 traits writing. We had that last year. We're implementing it this year. A lot of training for staff, you know, in order to make sure that they have what they need for these programs. We're working this summer on aligning our reading curriculum, English language arts curriculum. So we're always looking to see what areas we need to improve to give the best instruction we can for our students. We'll be undergoing an initiative called Response to Intervention. And at the next in-service in April, the staff will have an overview of that. And we'll be rolling out this program over 2 years. We kind of have a lot of the components in place now, but it'll be some scheduling changes, some staffing changes, and really providing our students with the intense instruction that they may need. So we're really looking forward to that. 36 hours of training for every staff person. So that, very excited about that.
Excellent. And some people may wonder, why so many new programs? Why a new math curriculum? Why RTI? And what I'd like to say is that something that we practice is basically, there's a name for it, which is total quality education, which means you look at the results, you study the data, and then you say, what do we need to change to improve our results? And sometimes it's curriculum, sometimes it's instruction, and sometimes you have to do multiple things. So we've improved the curriculum, we're improving instruction, we are coming up with a scope and sequence and a new English language arts curriculum for next year.
And using a lot of what we have, but just aligning it all together.
Absolutely. It's not so much that everything is so different.
Right.
It's just the emphasis, perhaps, is in a different place. And we hope to add, even amongst the budget cutting, and we have a shortfall in our budget. Mm-hmm. But even with that, the importance to me of having adequate supervision, to have people, supervisors, middle management, to be in classrooms working with teachers to help improve instruction and to see what issues are there, that we will add personnel, even though we're cutting personnel.
Right.
For these supervisory positions. It is not fair, or for quality, it's not going to occur when you have one principal who's in charge of evaluating 65 people a year. And I know that you have to evaluate secretaries and paraprofessionals and custodians. And I'm sorry if I leave anybody out of this, cafeteria workers.
That's the only group I don't have to do.
Teachers, paraprofessionals,
the assistant principal. Yes. Mm-hmm.
And ultimately, you are responsible for all of those people. And you need to work cooperatively with your assistant principal to help get all of this done. But you can't be in multiple places at the same time.
Correct.
With a few additional personnel as supervisors, it's potential that four people could be out in classrooms rather than just one.
Right.
And I think that's going to pay dividends to us, because people need help. Once they've been shown a new way to do something, they still have questions. It's the coaching part of it, of people going in and working with people, maybe giving them ideas, mm-hmm. or maybe just being a sounding board for somebody as they're trying some new program. I think will pay us dividends and things will be better.
I agree.
And it will take some time. You know, these new programs come in, people have to be trained in them, mm-hmm. they have to be implemented. Unfortunately, the research says that there usually is a downtick before things start going up.
Right. Sometimes it takes 3 years before you see the results of a new program.
Right. And we're all wanting miracles tomorrow. But the reality is sometimes it takes a while. And it's why when I talk to principals about plans for their building, I think we have to talk about 5 years. What is the plan? And it's, in this case, we're not really just talking about a building. It's really all three buildings.
That's correct.
Because you have staff in all three buildings. You need to work with that staff to work with children so that the children get the best possible education,
mm-hmm.
and have an education they can use. So we've talked about facilities. We've talked about assessment. We've talked about teaching and learning. Anything that we haven't talked about?
No, I mean, this is my ninth year here in Wareham, and every day there's always something new coming your way, even in the 9 years that I've been here. I can't do my job without two great assistant principals. So Mr. Peeling has been great this year working with the sustainability team, trying to promote positive discipline. We have a project that we're undertaking right now where we will be writing respect, responsibility, and kindness along the walls at Minot Forest. That's our theme that we've adopted this year. All the students signed a contract at the beginning of the year, and they traced their hands, and it's hanging outside of the classrooms. And then key words such as, this is important, we won't give up on you, we'll be writing those throughout the building as well. So we were fortunate at Minot Forest to get a grant from the Foundation for Education in Wareham. Mrs. Lennon, the art teacher, wrote that grant so we can buy the paint and supplies that we need for that and get some student involvement. And then Mrs. Ames has been great trying to help cover the Hammond School and the East Wareham School. So when I'm at Minot, she can take care of as much as she can, but they have great communication skills, keep me updated on absolutely everything. So whether it's an email or a phone call, I had to have my, well, they did it on their own, increase their text messaging plans on their cell phones, because that sometimes seems to be the best way to communicate. So we do a lot of conversing, you know, on our personal phones to keep updated, and they don't mind, and I certainly don't mind.
Excellent, excellent. Yes, the Foundation for Wareham Education gave out 3 awards at a recent function, and I know Nancy Lennon was one of the teachers to receive mm-hmm. the award. We look forward to seeing the work being done by the teacher and the students, and we hope somebody will capture it with some video, perhaps, that we can then also put on the webpage. That would be great. The messages, the themes of the school, that's part of what program?
Open Circle.
Open Circle.
That's the social-emotional program that we use in our discipline program for school. So the sustainability team that works with Mr. Paling came up with those 3 words. And every month we have a word of the month. And there's a board right outside of my office. And this month the word happens to be effort. And we thought it was a great word because we do have MCAS this month. And you should see the number of stars that are lining that board with students' names on it that have shown some type of effort, or they've gone above and beyond to show some effort in their classroom throughout the day. So another positive way just to promote things.
How do you find out about these students?
The teachers tell us. So we catch students being good, or the teachers will write down the names, and then the children come up and they put their star on the board.
Excellent, excellent. Mm-hmm. People have to understand that education, and in fact our mission, is educating students for life's challenges. And for them to be successful, it isn't just the academic knowledge.
Right.
It is also the social and emotional learning of how to work with others, you know, working in a team, being polite. Mm-hmm. Knowing how to get the information when you need it to do something with it. All of that's very important. And there's been a lot of talk about bullying and the fact that some students do things that we're not proud of. And the social and emotional education is a way to get kids to understand that being kind to one another will get them a lot farther in life than by making fun of people.
That's
so,
right.
It's an excellent program, and you're to be commended for it.
Thank you.
I look forward to seeing the scores as they come out.
As do I. The children have worked hard. The teachers have worked super hard on everything they have to do in their, you know, throughout their day. So we're looking forward to that as well.
Excellent. And anything else that we haven't covered about any one of the buildings?
I think we're good. We're moving right along. It's March. We did have kindergarten registration. So if there are families out there with children turning 5 on or before September 30th, please come to the Hammond School to register. We need to have those numbers to plan for next year, the number of classrooms that we're going to need. And that results in the number of teachers we're going to need for a grade level. So that's really important to make sure we register for kindergarten right now.
Excellent. And what about something about you? You've been in the district, you said, 9 years mm-hmm. as the principal of the school. You actually started, if I recall, as the principal of East and Hammond?
Yes, it was East and Hammond, and it was pre-K to 3 back when I came to Wareham. That was back with Dr. Legue as the superintendent.
And because of budget cuts and so forth, you've had to take a larger responsibility.
Yes.
And now double the number of children, and now you have 3 buildings and 3 schools. And before you came to Wareham, where did you work?
I was an assistant principal in Carver, pre-K to 2 at a primary school, and I was there for 4 years. And then before Carver, I was a teacher in Middleborough, and I taught there for 11 years, taught 3rd grade and 1st grade. So I've always been in the early childhood area.
I think it's important for people to realize that it's something that we think is very important here, that having administrators and principals who have been classroom teachers is very important, because and not just doing it for 3 years or 5 years, but by doing it for 11 years, you know what it's like to work with children, to work with families, how to implement changes from the teacher perspective as well as the administrator. It's something that I've always been proud of, the fact that I spent 13 years in a classroom before going into administration. And it's just a nice thing to have. In fact, our entire administrative team, you know, with Mr. Palladino now at the high school and his, you know, years in the classroom, I think we're also 11 or 12.
I have to say, I'm very fortunate to be working with a great administrative team in Wareham, because it makes my job easier when I know I have the support and we're all working towards one goal. We have a very respectful team. We listen to each other. We help each other out. You know, I don't think that happens everywhere you go. So I love being here in Wareham. And I remember Dr. Legue, probably one of the questions he had asked was, you know, why do you want to be a principal? And I said, well, I want to be able to help children other than the 20 to 25 children in my class. I want to be able to help more children. Well, I guess I got my wish with 3 elementary schools. So it's very busy. But it's great.
Close to 700 children, I believe?
Over 800, because I have the district preschool program.
Over 800.
Yes.
Well, I want to thank you for your time. I know it's Friday afternoon, but it's been a pleasure, and thank you very much
coming
and having a conversation with the superintendent.
Anytime.
Thank you, and we hope that you will tune in to our school committee meetings, that you visit us at Town Hall. I do not plan to be evicted, as some people may have heard, from Town Hall. And tune in to Conversations with the Superintendent for more information about the schools in Wareham. Thank you.